So for those of you who've been loyal members of these evenings, you notice we have a new jingle, Tell Me More. So welcome to our first live Tell Me More session of this evening. For the next 20 minutes, well, I see on my clock it's actually 24 minutes, we'll dive deeper into the topic of dynamic navigation with Dr. Mike Block. And remember, this is Channel One, we are live. So make sure you make the most of this session by submitting any questions you might have. They will end up right here on my desk. Now, Dr. Mike Block is now joining us live from the United States. Good afternoon. Thank you for being with us. Where exactly are you tonight?
I am in New Orleans, Louisiana, which is in the south part of the states. Exactly. And I'm in my office because it's noontime here at where I live. So it's during lunch hour, which is perfect. And we're just waiting for a hurricane to hit New Orleans in 2 days. So it's an exciting time. We're trying to make sure everything's good. Exactly. But I want to thank you for the invitation to join you. You have a great organization.
Well, thank you for the very kind words. Thank you for sharing your lunch break with us here in this evening in Paris. And we're happy that you are able to join us via this live connection. You are a clinical professor at the LSU School of Dentistry in New Orleans. You also run your private practice, as we can see behind you. Now, it's obvious that when placing implants or performing grafting, that accuracy and precision is the key. And scientific evidence using clinical trials is confirming that navigation will result in more accurate and more precise implant placement. So let's start with the basis. What do you mean when we talk about dynamic navigation tonight?
Well, there's two ways of placing an implant. One is it looks about right, drill a hole and put it in. And then the second one is to put it in with some sort of guidance and sophistication. So static navigation is when you use a drill guide with tubes in it. And dynamic is when you've prepared with your navigation system all of the images so that when you're drilling your holes, you're looking at a screen and it's live. So you're actually looking at the drill going into the bone on the screen from the navigation. Same way neurosurgeons or orthopedic surgeons do surgery with navigation. Same thing. It's very accurate. It's instead of 8 degrees off of perfect, it's 2 degrees. It's much, much more accurate, which is good for the patients.
Yeah, that's quite a significant gain. Now, for people who have never used dynamic navigation before, how easy or hard is the learning curve? Because it's a total new way of working, I assume.
Well, it is. But navigation's been out in the medical science community for a long, long time. And what they've shown statistically is if you do simulation, you'll improve your learning curve. The second is if you do over the shoulder, where you're watching somebody do it, you'll get better at it. So my residents are with me part of the time, and then they do it at the school. And when I watch them first time, they put their drill in and they're trying to hit that right spot. They're all over the place. But within two cases, they're spot on. It's really quick, unless you really have a dyslexic disorder, but most people don't. So it's very simple. It takes a couple little practice steps. It's good to practice, but it's very quick to pick up. It's incredible. The first case you do, you're 4 degrees better than if you didn't do it.
Yeah, exactly. So you say that when someone who never done this before gets their first hands on it, they immediately see results. You mentioned two cases and you're already able to do it. What are some tips from your experience that what people can do to reduce that learning curve?
Well, they need to practice. They need to take a mannequin and actually practice their positioning so they're comfortable, their body is relaxed, and they need to practice watching the screen and moving their hands. Once they do that, it's a matter of just how much precision they look at the screen and how accurate they are. But you're still the surgeon. You still have to drill the hole and prepare the tissue. And so you still do surgery. It's not a robotic thing. You'll still do it.
I can imagine that is very counterintuitive. If you've always been looking at your hands and you have this eye-hand coordination of what you want to do, how was that when you first came across this dynamic navigation workflow?
Oh, it was hard. I'm older than the younger people. I think I'm older than you, I believe. I think I am. And you probably play more video games or maybe use more video things. But I tend to think I'm a sort of a techno nerd in a way. But the first one I practiced with was bad. The second model that I tried was much, much better. And by the third one, I was spot on. But in the patient, it's how you position yourself. So I had to to relearn how to position. And then it was, then it was easy. It's just a matter of going through the thought process and spending some time before you start on a patient to train yourself.
Exactly. Now, for those of us who are quite new, can you share with us what the workflow looks like when we work with these dynamic navigation tools?
Sure. From the workflow point of view, the patient comes in and they have to have a fiduciary or a reference point put on their jaws. So it's a little clip that we just put it in the mouth. It's got three BBs on it. And we put it in, and then we take the scan with that, and then we're ready to go. I put that onto my navigation system, the computer. I pull it up. I draw the nerve out. The planning takes 5 minutes, literally 5 minutes on the software. It's so much easier than any of the other CT planning softwares I've seen. It's just remarkable. So there's very little downtime. I have them come in as a consult. I'm ready to operate on them within 30 minutes or the next day.
But so you say it's very quick and fast. Others say, how does the speed of the procedure compare to a more traditional guided surgery with a static guide?
For sure. So you have to set everything up. So my assistants set everything up, all the instruments, and they calibrate the machine. So you have to calibrate the drill and just get everything calibrated. That takes about 10 minutes, but my staff does that. So I walk in the room, I numb the patient up, make my incision and use it. And typically it's 8 to 10 minutes an implant. It doesn't take longer. The first one you do will take longer, of course. The second one will take longer, but by the 50th, 30th, 20th, you'll be right there. So it doesn't take me any longer to do surgery, and it's much more accurate.
So, and what tips do you have for us on how to increase the efficiency of this workflow? Because this you talk about this in a huge increase. What were the steps where you quickly gained more time if some of us who are new to the technique feel like, this is taking so much longer?
Well, you have to have the philosophy that you want to put the implants in more accurate than anything else. They have to go in better than we traditionally do. If you look at your own post-op CT scans of your patients, you'll see problems sometimes. So you have to have the mindset to do this right. It's a mindset. And it may take you a little bit longer. But I don't care about that. If it takes me a little longer, that's fine. When I was younger, I thought I had to operate very quickly. But now that I'm getting older, and when I talk to my older colleagues, more mature colleagues, we all agree we're operating slower and having more fun and doing it better. So I don't think time is a big issue with it. If someone has a matter of 5 minutes in their time schedule that they can't do this, I can't deal with that. I don't know.
So you say we are talking about time differences of 5 minutes, because I've been talking to colleagues of you who refer to that it might take 10 times longer than a traditional analog or a guided surgery approach.
No, they're just, no. That's not true.
Okay. Well, obviously here at EAO, we're very curious to learn about the scientific background of these statements. I mean, you're sharing your personal clinical experience. Are you aware of some studies that have been comparing these new techniques with guided surgery?
Well, we've published several articles on the accuracy, and the accuracy is much better than freehand. If you use the freehand approach, I call it the eyeball approach, where you're just looking, it's definitely better. There's no doubt about it. It's about the same as a static guide. So I wouldn't say it's better than a static guide, but it's more versatile. So in that regard, we know the accuracy is there, and all the other studies have shown the same thing. The accuracy is the key. It's very accurate. When we started, we actually timed ourselves, not trying to do it fast, but to see, and across the board, we were pretty similar placing a regular implant or using with this, maybe a minute longer, maybe 2 minutes longer. So instead of 10 minutes, it would take us 12 minutes. That's not bad.
So you're saying to all the colleagues who say it takes much longer, that is just a matter of getting used to it, and it's going through the learning curve that will tackle that.
That's exactly right. It's just the learning curve and getting your setup geared to it. Every implant I place is guided now. Everyone. Without exception.
Only the more complex cases, or even the simple ones?
Yeah, the simple ones too. And I'm left-handed, so the right side, they go in straight as an arrow, and they're just set up right. And if I have to angle them, I just do it. It's no big deal. Every single one, every day, all day long.
Wow, that's quite a bold statement here. And you mentioned briefly the topic of accuracy. Obviously, it makes sense that it's much more accurate than a freehand procedure. But what are the figures compared to a guided surgery? Do you have any data on that?
Well, the static guides are very similar to the dynamic navigation guides as far as the accuracy. They're both within 2 to 3 millimeters, 2 to 3 degrees of accuracy versus 8 degrees freehand. The initial point where it puts it in, they're all very accurate. So it's really angulation and spacing. But if you look, it's fine, but the static guides take time to make. You know, someone's got to make them. The printers, people are printing their own guides, but the printers have inaccuracies to them. It's just more precise, and it's very efficient. I mean, patient comes in, I'm guided. I put virtual teeth on, I'm ready to go. If I have a more complicated arch, I scan them with my intraoral scanner, I stitch that, superimpose it on, put virtual teeth on, and ready to go, 10 minutes. And I'm not that quick, but it's not that much to it. It's very simple. It's wonderful.
You definitely make it sound very simple, yet it doesn't seem, at least, and maybe this is a difference between our continents, maybe it's a different in the USA than here in Europe, but it doesn't seem that everyone is already doing this in their practice. What do you think is holding them back?
Yeah, first of all, most people who place implants think they do it really well the way they do it. So they don't even look to improve. Many people don't even take post-operative CT scans. They say, well, that's just the way it is. Static guides work great. So if you're using a lot of static guides, you're fine. But it's the subtlety of just being able to plan every case and look at every case in detail. And that's the consistency of making sure it's right. So they're all spot on. You still have to do the surgery, but all of a sudden you're using it for things that you didn't think you could do otherwise. So that's what I was going to show you, some of the places that I'm doing it now that I couldn't do it if I just freehanded it or used static guides. So there's some different.
Yeah, we're curious. Please share with us.
Can I share my screen
with
you?
Yes, definitely you can.
Let me do that now. And then and you'll see what I'm talking about. So just a couple of things as we go through this. But I wanted to show you, I do this all day long, every day. You can see all the different cases. I mean, I have slides after slides every day, all day long. So I use this not for special cases or complex cases, because all the cases are the same. But one of the things I find is useful is, for instance, doing an immediate implant with sinus grafting. So what I do is I take what you see in your screen here is the 3D and the implant, but if you notice, it's just to the top of the sinus floor. And then when I put the implant in, when I'm drilling, I'm looking at the screen now when I'm drilling. So I'm trying to get that little circle in the middle. And now if you look up in the upper, up in the middle, and you can see the drill going as it's right on line. It's as is. You're looking at the screen and I'm looking at that middle screen more than anything. And you see, I'm getting right to that 5 millimeter point and I am right underneath the sinus floor, right underneath it. So I continue to prepare that. So once I get one drill in, I keep on going with all the other drills and I can make sure that I could drill just at the right length, just at the right height. And then when I'm done, I pop it up with my osteotomes, put the grafts in, and then I go to the final distance. And you notice you can see my bald head there. I'm looking at the screen as I'm doing this. So I could not do this without this system. It doesn't work. And if you look at the implants, you see that I'm able to put them in. And in this case, as you see on the left, I put an opposing occlusion on it. That's the gray. I've put virtual teeth. I put the implants in. And when I guide the implants with this, I'm ready to go. So it took me 5 minutes to scan the patient intraorally, very good scanners. And then I put the image on and then I put the virtual teeth on and I put the implants on the screen. And it took me literally 8 to 10 minutes to do that. And then I'm ready to go. And then I just follow the line and I put the implants in. And the other thing, I'll tell you another thing that's interesting. When I work with my aesthetic colleagues, and so this group is great, you know, and I was doing a lateral incisor in a young lady where aesthetics were key. And the prosthodontist said, can you distalize the height of contour half millimeter? And I said, sure. So if you look at the screen with the circle, you see those marks, those tick marks are 1 millimeter marks. So I'm just on the half to 3/4 millimeter to the distal. And I know that sounds trivial, but for him, a millimeter was huge in this young lady. He wanted to distalize the height of contour on the lateral incisor, a half a millimeter. So I put the implant in, 0.5 millimeter distal. from the height of contour. And I did it with the navigation system. Now, a static guide on this would be really hard. I could do it with that. It would still be really hard. So this was online. That's what he told me. And he's standing there taking pictures and things like that. And you can see it's very simple to do. And we're just drilling our hole. And then when you end up with is something like this. This is the result. And you see the height of contour in that lateral is distalized about a half a millimeter, which is perfect. That's what you want. So when I can do that, it's good. The other thing I do with the navigation is when I'm doing my immediate molars, I take the tooth out, and if there's no reason otherwise, I drill a hole. And so you see on this series of drills, on the left, you see the septum. And then on the middle, you see a hole. Now, I use the drills that rotate in reverse, the osseodensification drills to do this. I put the drill in, and I'm doing it guided. And then I'm coming in and out, and I'm widening the bone, but I'm making sure that the drill stays where I want it to stay by the navigation. I'm key on the navigation. So once I get the prep done, I put the implant in. So to show you, this is just not that same case, but another case on the lower. And you see, you make sure everything is just right. So you do your system checks to make sure your spacing is just right. And it's not hard to do. They have a new X mark, which makes it really easy. And now I'm drilling right in the septum. So I'm right in the septum. And you see, I'm right in the middle of the circle. Now, that means that if my plan is right, then this should be accurate to the half millimeter. So it's a very accurate system. And you see, I'm going to make sure the drills stay where I put them. And by doing that, they're not bouncing. So I'm still drilling the hole. You have to be the surgeon. You have to be the drill. And as I just find this to be a very easy adjunct. This is much easier. The static guides doing this on an immediate molar with a septum is very difficult because the drills still have a little slop in them and they'll move around. So this works great. And I put the implant in, you can see it's relatively well centered. And I know you could do this with your eyeball and just doing it, but it's easy. So, you know, how many cases do you need to learn how to do this?
Mike, if I may briefly interrupt, if you take down your screen, because you just said something interesting that relates to a live viewer question that we have, because you mentioned, if I set up the system right, then it's just easy, go and do it. Orlando Alvarez is sending in a question live now. He's saying, how easy or difficult is it to set up and calibrate the system before the surgery? Because obviously, when that is a little bit off, that error takes all the way into the entire workflow.
Sure. So the first thing is the clip. You have to get the clip in the right place, and it has to be done right. But it's very easy to do. So the clip should just snap in and out. And once you learn how to do it, it's easy. There are some teeth with higher contour problems, but if you have that, now they have a system where you can surface map and correct that. So it's pretty simple to correct that by refining it. So, yeah. But to set it up, the machine has just a drill and a fiducial marker. It's just two things. So you just follow it, and you put the drill under the lights, and you rotate it, and it's calibrated. And you do the same thing with the fiducial on the array. And then what you do is you take your drill, and you put it on top of a plate, and that gives you the distance.
Exactly.
And then you're ready to go. So it's literally, my assistants, it takes them 5 to 7 minutes to set it up. It's easy. And then you get trained. I mean, the people who sell you these things come and train you, so it's even easier. You have to live.
But Mike, it sounds like that this fiducial marker is really key to the success. I can imagine that maybe, does that ever get moved, or are there any discrepancies that could then lead to a potential error of the system?
Sure. Every little step has to be perfect. So the CT scan has to be done right. The fiducial, the clip has to be on right. But if the clip is on, and let's say you go to your calibration and you find out instead of being right on the tooth, you're a little off of the tooth. Well, then you can take the array and move it. But there's a little refinement setup that they have where you go, you just put it on the teeth and you go around in a circle and you do that 3 times and it refines it. So it's a surface mapping. And the surface mapping is actually used in the armed forces for a lot of things they do. And a lot of surface mapping is done in industry. So it's actually taking technology that other industries have used and bringing it back to this. Once you do it, you're there. It's just a mindset. You just have to believe in the system.
You make it really, really sound really easy. Mike, a last question, short one, from Alain from Paris. You quickly referenced it when you were showing your case. You mentioned this was all online, and it triggered me already. Alain is writing, do you think this is the first step towards telemedicine? Do we have to be in the same room to be able to guide the surgery like this?
Yeah, you really still you have the drill in your hand.
Why is that important, Mike? Why is it important that the surgeon is still moving the drill? Why can't the robot do that?
Any robotic system, even a robotics person, anyone doing robotic surgery in the hospital, they're still running the robot. They're
exactly
there.
But that would allow for people to be in different places, right? Because you can manage the robot from the United States here in Paris.
The key on all the navigations is you have to have rigid control of the jaw. So something has to be rigidly on it to give you. That's the first thing. And then it has to be set up locally to be able to drill a hole. And then after that, sure, robotics can do it. But once they get to that point, that'll be very expensive. Some of the robotics systems out now are gorgeous. They're absolutely gorgeous, but they are very expensive.
Okay, so you say that's not yet ready for now, but it might be the future.
Oh, yeah, I think you're going to have robotics and you're going to have the virtual glasses. You ever see those?
Yeah, definitely.
You're going to be glasses. Instead of looking at the screen, you'll be looking at your patient, but everything will be inside on the glasses and everything will be moving. Yeah, that's just a matter of the engineers and the programmers figuring it out. They're working on it. I know they're working on it.
Wow.
It's amazing.
Mike, you are very, very passionate about this topic. It's great to have your energy here with us in our studio in Paris. Now, we're nearing the end of our 20 minutes already. So to summarize for our viewers, what are the most important take-home messages that you really want them to remember from this session?
Oh, I think you have to just, anything you can do to place an implant more accurately and efficiently on your patient is better. Accuracy is the key. And so whatever you need to do in your practice to do that, that's the way to do it. You have to navigate. You have to. And if you navigate with a static guide or a dynamic, that's up to you. I just find efficiently the dynamic system is much easier, much better for my time in my practice, in my day. I want to have some time to go home and enjoy a glass of, you know, whatever. I don't want to be doing this at night. I don't want to be making guides or having somebody make a guide for me that's not accurate. So I do the dynamic system. It's just cost effective and time effective and patient effective.
Wow. Yeah. Well, thank you for your time and an honor that you wanted to be available on our first Tell Me More About of this session. You definitely told us more about the dynamic navigation and you shared your passion with us. Now, as you said in the beginning, you're bracing for a hurricane in 2 days. So we all hope that you stay safe and you get well out of that.
Thank you. Hopefully it'll be a little west. Okay. I'm sorry for those people, but better for me.
Exactly.
Thanks again for having me. And if anyone ever wants to ask me a question, email me.
Mike, I please move to our channel 8 because I'm now going to make a call to action to our viewers who still have questions that we didn't pick up. If you have done that, please go to the channel 8. Tell me more about After Discussion Lounge. It's a chat box where hopefully Mike will now also join you. The other participants will join you and you can actually continue the conversation about dynamic navigation.